This station, we're going to do a little walking, but let's start off on the bridge. I want everyone to look over the edges of the bridge. I want you to look at the rocks under the bridge and compare them. Ladies, compare the rocks under the bridge to the rocks that are further up and further downstream. So take about 10 seconds to do that. About the rocks.
They're white.
Okay, they're white. What else?
They're bigger over there and smaller over here.
Okay, smaller underneath us. They're bigger upstream and bigger downstream. Okay, why are they, why do we see two differences?
Are we going to be able to walk?
Because there's small rocks can be carried further.
Small rocks can be carried further, but if we look downstream, there's big rocks. What happened?
Fall down.
When they built the bridge, they took out the big rocks.
Okay, that could be. Now, what's going to move the small rocks?
Water.
Water. People. What's going to move big rocks?
People.
Could water move big rocks?
No.
Okay, it can, but you have to have a lot more water, don't you? Okay, so notice that under the bridge it's fairly flat, and we're not going to get the water moving as fast. So the smaller rocks settle out to the bottom. But upstream and downstream, it's steeper, so the water's going to move faster, and you're going to get the small rocks being pushed downstream, further down to where it's calm. Does that make sense? Okay, so what is one way we erode rocks? Move it to a new place.
Water.
Okay, good. We're going to walk right up here, and we've got to get out to the point out there, guys, so we are going to move quickly. You're going to walk quickly, okay? So, okay? What can happen here in the winter time is water seeps down into those cracks, and then what happens to it?
It expands.
It freezes, it expands, and pops those rocks apart, breaks them apart. Okay, what do we call that?
Weathering.
Okay, it is a type of weathering called ice wedging. Okay? So what's the second way we erode rocks? By ice. Ice wedging, that pops them off, and then they can fall down. Okay? We gotta head up that. Up the... Whatever we call that. Up the ravine, so to speak. Okay. Notice the erosion that's come down there through all of that. Okay, so did you see the ravine up above?
Oh.
Where it washed out that I told you to look up there? Okay, this is the bottom of that. Not all of this happened last week, but enough. Hey, guys, over here. Right over here. Look this way. Hey. I need your attention. Okay. Right here, all of that, you saw all those ravines up there. Last week's rain that we were supposed to be here in, right? We canceled our field trip because of it. That washed down through here and washed a bunch of dirt onto this trail. They had to bring some tractors in this week, and they pushed all of that extra soil off to the side here. So this wasn't washed out this much last week. So again, an example of erosion by what?
Water.
Okay, a couple things going on here. First of all, if we look out towards Utah Lake, okay, everyone look out towards Utah Lake. I will refrain from laughing on that one. Long ago, the water level of that lake came up to right where we're standing. Okay? It filled this whole valley. It filled the Salt Lake Valley. It went all the way to southern Idaho and all the way south to central and southern Utah. Okay? Does anyone know the name of that lake?
Bonneville.
Okay, Lake Bonneville. Lake Bonneville. It was a huge lake, okay? Where we're standing was one of the shorelines. It was up to this level, and where the waves crashed on the shore, they were crashing right in this area. Okay, ladies, gentlemen, please listen, okay? Now, there are various levels of that, so if we look down below, we see some other flat areas, and those were when the level of the water was lower, and that created beaches in those areas. Again, up in southern Idaho, there's an area where the rocks that were holding back the lake broke loose, and a huge flood drained through there, and that's what caused the lake to drain over lots of years. Okay, so what was left behind? We had the Great Salt Lake left behind, we had Utah Lake left behind, and then we had Sevier Lake, which is kind of a big mud puddle. And those were left behind, as well as some just tiny little areas also, okay? All right, what else is going on in this area? So let's look to the south, okay? Where the power lines are. And up on this hillside, what do you know about this area?
It's rocky.
It is rocky. Okay, so the eyes over here, and we'll show you some things. So if we look at that area, and if you can see my whiteboard, that'll help, okay? So if we draw kind of maybe the mountain up there and it drops off and we get the power lines right there, then drops off and we get the road there and it comes out and there's a house there, some houses, and drops off again. Okay, and out here. Okay, so that's kind of the what we're seeing. So let me show you a couple things with that. What mountains are these that we're living along? What do we call these mountains? Whoops. So these are the Wasatch Mountains. Turn that sideways, right? Yep. Tip it up so the wide spot's on top. Flip it. There you go. Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay. These are the Wasatch Mountains. If you continue west and you go across Nevada into California, we hit a big mountain range just as we cross from Nevada into California. Does anyone know the name of that big mountain range? It's called the Sierra Nevadas. Okay, the Sierra Nevadas. Now what's happening is between right here, ladies, between right here where we're standing, the exact spot where we're standing, and the Sierra Nevadas, the earth is getting stretched, it's getting pulled apart. And as it gets pulled apart, what happens? Okay, we get parts that fall and parts that go up. Okay, so if we were to take a look at this, what's happening right here is this is getting stretched apart, and so parts dropping down and parts up. Do you see that over there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So what do we call this line between the two blocks of rock?
A fault.
Okay, that's a fault. And so if we take our picture again, and again we have some houses down here, we take that picture, we've got a fault line running down there off that ledge where it flattens out to more houses. So there's a fault that runs there, and there's a fault right by the road there. Okay, where that drops off, there's a fault deep underground. Okay, so as this area gets stretched apart, these blocks slip down, and this block goes up, and we get taller mountains and lower valleys.
Are the fault lines visible?
The fault lines are visible at certain places along here. A lot of them, the erosion comes in and covers up that fault line. Does that make sense? But you can, that's the line right there that you see. Okay, now what do you notice around these fault lines?
Houses.
Why would someone build a house right on top of a fault line? I can assure you these houses are not cheaper, okay? Sometimes it's cheaper.
The land is cheaper.
Sometimes it's cheaper, but in this case, they're more expensive. Why are they more expensive lots?
They're close to the mountains. Yeah.
They're close to the mountains. They're higher up, and therefore you have a better
view.
So people are paying for that view, okay? But they're also sitting right on top of a fault. So why would they risk it, okay? They obviously, the view is more important, and they feel like the risk of earthquakes is very low. We haven't had an earthquake for a long time, not in any of our lifetimes, or our grandparents' lifetimes, or our great-grandparents' lifetimes. So what's the chance of having an earthquake? And they feel it's pretty low, okay? But we are on an active fault line right here, and so these mountains are constantly building, and the valleys are constantly dropping. Okay, any questions on that? So we'll talk more about that. Oh, one more thing along those lines, guys, is the earthquake doesn't make the mountains move. The moving mountains make an earthquake. Okay, the moving fault creates the earthquake. Okay? All right, any questions? Okay. We're going to have you walk back along here, cross the bridge, and there's a little trail that heads up to the left after the bridge. That'll be station two. What's that?
Yep.
So my station is about rocks. So these rocks that you're on are actually 500 million years old. So if you want any of these on the ground, just just eroded, weathered and eroded from the cliff here. If you want to take one with you, so you can remember better what we talked about, when you look at the rock, it's a great idea. Just one that's small enough that can fit in your pocket and not feel heavy. 500 million year old rocks formed through glaciers. Okay? Now, wait a minute. I don't see any glaciers around here, do you? Yeah, so what was the environment here in Rock Canyon 500 million years ago?
It was cold.
Yeah, it was a lot different than it is now. So in your notes, you've got a little rectangle outlined on the page that says Station 3 and 4. You need to write that down, that these rocks are formed by glaciers, and they're called tillite, and that's spelled T-I-L-L-I-T-E. Tillite, and they're 500 million years old.
Tillite on Station 4.
Got it.
Yep, formed by glaciers. So what the glaciers did, when they move over the land, they grind up and smash down any rocks that are on the surface, and that forms sediment. Now you guys know the rock cycle. What happens after rocks get weathered and eroded by glaciers and form sediment? Then what? Somebody tell us, what happens next? Yep, compressed together. And that's what you see here. Especially, take a look at this. This part of the tillite actually shows where some of the rocks didn't get ground up into powder. So we have rocks in a rock.
Wait, what are we supposed to write down?
The tillite is formed from glaciers 500 million years old. Up here in the notes section.
Oh, that's Station 3. Oh, yeah, yeah, okay. Okay, I got it.
So we have older rocks within a younger rock. Those are called inclusions, and that was in your field trip packet that you guys should have gone over the last week. Okay, so glacial rocks on the bottom. Now let's take a look up top. You can see that it's a totally different color. These rocks down here are brown to black, and up there they're kind of a whatever color that is. Tan, reddish brown, cream color, right? Completely different type of rock. Those rocks are made from sand that's gone through metamorphosis. So if you put sand through metamorphosis, what's going to happen to the sand? Metamorphic rock. Come on, guys. You know the rock cycle. What happens? Metamorphosis or metamorphic rocks?
She never explained it.
What happens? Don't tell me you have sunstroke already and you can't think.
Yep, I do.
Okay. Metamorphism in the earth uses heat and pressure to change rocks. So it changes loose sand into rocks that are like those up there. That's called quartzite. So the next word in your notes, quartzite. Q-U-A-R-T-Z-I-T-E. Quartzite. And those are made from sand. Now what's interesting about Rock Canyon is that we have glacier rocks here on the bottom and sandy rocks, the quartzite rocks, up on top. How can that happen? They don't even form in the same kind of environment. Yeah, that's a question I want you to think about at the reflection station. How can you have rocks that form in one environment here, right, with glaciers, and in a sandy type environment like deserts or beaches or whatever up there on top? So when you get to the reflection station, which is Station 4, that's one of the questions I want you to answer. There's two more questions, or another one I want you to answer, that's on the bottom of your packet. Do you see it down there? It talks about the rock cycle. Mm-hmm. So you put your heads together and come up with the answer to that question about the rock cycle at the reflection station. Also, don't forget, you need to be looking for pictures to take that will help you do your PowerPoint project, right? You need plants, you need animals, that includes insects and things like that. You need pictures of the rocks and minerals that are up here. So if you want to take a picture of the tillite from here, you can. Or actually, when you get down on the road down there, there's actually a better view But I wanted you right up here in the rock so you can touch them and see what's going on. So if you wanted to collect one, go ahead and do it.
Okay, you guys, this is a good picture for you to get right here. These two boulders have come from that cliff up there. Okay, are there two different types of rock, right, as you look at them? Can you look at these rocks, guys, and show me that there are two different types, right? Listen, one is dolomite and one is limestone. When we've been talking about erosion in class, we've been talking about erosion and sediments, okay? Girls, what has to happen first before erosion can happen?
Ooh, weathering.
Weathering, good. So what happens to these cliffs is rock or water seeps down in between the cracks of the rock, and the water expands and it breaks apart those rocks. But look at these two huge boulders. What forces of nature would have had to have carried these rocks from way up there to down here to deposit on each other? Okay, gravity for sure is one, right? They're gonna fall from there and they're gonna come down here. What else?
Water.
Water, right? Do you think just a little bit of water would carry these two huge rocks all the way here?
No, it must have been like a lot of water.
Yeah, the history of this canyon is that there's been huge floods that have come through here. Okay, and that's the only thing that could have moved these two rocks all the way from up there, all the way down here to deposit on top of each other. And we can tell that they haven't been like rolling around and going for years and years and years, because they still have their rocky, kind of their rugged edges to them, okay? So they fell from that cliff and came down here and were deposited because of some serious forces of nature. Okay, so we're talking at this station about ecology. Okay, this is the station you're gonna need in order to put your PowerPoint together with a food chain or a food web, okay? Who can tell me what ecology means? So ology means the study of. You put a prefix on that and it means the study of whatever you put up there, okay? So if I were to say biology, what is that the study of? Bio, life, right? If I say geology, what is that the study of? Rocks, okay, or earth. So we're talking about ecology here. So what is ecology the study of? Any guesses?
Economy.
Not the economy, that's a good guess. What else? What is it the study of, guys?
Life cycle.
Okay, that's a good guess.
Wait, what did he say?
The life cycle?
No.
Are you asking what that
means?
Yes, what does ecology mean?
Oh, ecology? Nature.
Okay, nature, that's a good guess. Okay, write this down. You should be on your packet in station 5 writing some little bit of notes. Ecology is the study of organisms and how they interact. I'll say that again, okay? Ecology
is
the study of organisms and how they interact with each other.
Yes.
So when we're talking about an ecosystem up here, girls, I need you listening over there, okay? What was different about the ecosystem or the surroundings in the bottom of the canyon versus when you come up here to the top of the canyon? Any changes you saw? What changes did you see from the bottom of the canyon to the top of the canyon?
More shade.
More shade. Good, Parker. Where do we get shade from?
Trees.
Trees. Okay. So as you come up the canyon, it's more deserty down there, right? And you get up here and there's pine trees, there's lots more vegetation, okay? So what that does is it enables more organisms to live up here, more diverse organisms, okay? You have bigger things like bears, cougars, squirrels, those types of things that are gonna live up here where there's more food sources. Then down in the deserty part of the canyon, okay? You're gonna get things like snakes, lizards. Have you guys seen any lizards?
No.
Okay, there's got to be lots of lizards.
I saw a bird nest.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Cool. So birds are going to live, you know, throughout the canyon, but there's more places for birds to hide and to live in these big pine trees, right? So you're going to get more diversity up here. So in terms of ecology, we need to talk about how energy flows through a system, okay? Energy flows through through this area. So first of all, the first word you're going to need to know is producers. Okay, you can write this down. What's a producer? I'll give you a hint. It produces its own food.
Plants.
Plants, good. These plants are producers. They produce their own food with the help of?
Sun.
The sun. Okay, they go through photosynthesis and produce food. That is the first level, or a producer, okay? In any ecosystem, you've got to have enough producers to sustain the life that is going to live in that area. So then we have consumers. You can write this down. A consumer eats the producer, okay? Consumer would eat the producer. What would be an example of something that eats a green plant?
A rabbit.
A rabbit, okay, insects, grasshoppers,
frogs.
Butterflies, frogs, anything like that.
There's no frogs here, right?
With up there a little bit further, they're going to find water, and yes, there would be some frogs.
Wait, we're going more up?
No, we're done. We're done for today. If you want to go up there later, there's,
no.
Not today, but on your own with your family or something, there's cool stuff up there, too. But this was far enough. Okay, so a first-level consumer eats a producer. Second-level consumer eats that first level consumer. Okay, so we're talking about like a mouse that would eat a grasshopper that has eaten the plants. Third level consumer is going to eat the mouse that has eaten the grasshopper that has eaten the producer, okay? So we're talking like a hawk or an eagle or different animals, okay? So the third level consumer is usually going to be a carnivore, something that would eat a mouse or a chipmunk or something like that, okay? So as energy flows through an ecosystem, we look at it and we study it that way. We see that the energy from the plant is passed on to the first level consumer, the grasshopper, who then passes that along to the mouse, who then passes that along to the hawk that has just eaten it. That is an example of a food chain, which you guys are going to have to create when we get back for your PowerPoint. So a good food chain, green plants of some sort, insects or something that eats that green plant, so a grasshopper, a mouse, and then the fourth level or third level would be like a hawk or an eagle. Okay? And that energy, where did you guys get the energy that you have right now?
I have energy.
I know you don't have any left, but what did you you ate for lunch. What type of energy is that? We've just talked about energy.
Chemical,
good. Stored chemical energy we get from our food. Same thing happens in an ecosystem, okay? When the grasshopper eats that plant, it's getting stored chemical energy. When the mouse eats that grasshopper, it's getting some stored chemical energy. When the hawk eats the mouse, again, it's getting some more energy. So that's how energy flows through an ecosystem. Okay? Now, on your way back down, you've got to go to station 6 where you're going to take some reflections, some pictures.
How many more stations do we need to go?
I think there's two more. But listen, on the way back down, I want you guys to look on the left-hand side of the wall. There's some lichens and moss. That comes in and breaks down rock, okay? So those are the first things they attach to rock, and they break that down and they make soil out of that so that other things can come in. Also look for good examples of erosion, okay? Rocks that are just falling down the mountain, take some pictures, lots and lots of pictures. Have fun. You have two more stations, and we'll see you guys back down to the buses, okay?
Howard. I'm student teaching with Mr. Stowers this semester. Oh, that's where I come from. That's this spot here. This is probably my favorite spot in the canyon. Not only is there decent shade, but we can see a lot of interesting stuff from here, a lot of the important features that we need. So we're going to just start at the top and talk through real quick what we're looking at. So starting up there, the very top of the peak, the gray rock up there. You want to guess what kind of rock that is?
Quartzite.
Sedimentary?
Yes, it is sedimentary rock. Good. How do you know it's sedimentary?
Oh, because you can see the layers.
Right, so you can see the layers. See? That's your best hint, you're looking at sedimentary rock. Okay. So most of what's up there is limestone. Okay. Are you guys all listening?
Yes.
Okay, so most of what's up there is limestone. Okay, limestone is a rock that's formed mostly from the shells and bodies of little organisms, little animals, most of things like corals.
the things that live at the bottom of lakes and oceans, okay? So if we know that, what does that tell us about this area?
It's covered by water.
Yeah, at one point this must have been covered by area, covered by water. And it covered for a pretty good amount of time to make that much rock, right? Okay, so what about this next one below it? What about all this orange rock around us?
Quartzite.
Quartzite, okay. What type is that? You know? Can you get one guess? What type of rock quartzite is?
Pyrite, I have no clue.
So let's look at some clues here. Do you see layers here?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this is the same formation as that, so let's look at that one. How do the layers look there compared to the limestone?
Wider.
Do they look nice and even like the limestone?
No.
Yeah, these layers are all twisted and warped. You know, it almost looks like someone took them and just kind of mashed them all together like a ball of Play-Doh. So, what we're actually looking at, quartzite, is a metamorphic rock. Okay? So metamorphic rocks, how do you form those? What do you need?
Heat and pressure,
right? So, at some point, all of this rock, this used to be sandstone, all this orange rock, used to be sandstone, and then it was buried deep enough so there was enough heat and pressure to change it to this quartzite rock. It's all to form and melted like this. That makes sense? Everyone see how that works? So what do you think, these layers back here, if we know that sedimentary rock layers originally formed flat, so why are these layers not flat? Anyone want to guess?
They look compression?
Pretty much straight up and down. That's a good guess, you said compression. Okay. So. We can't always tell by looking at it directly exactly what caused it, but we know that something, whether it's compression or tension or something, caused these flat layers to be tilted like this, and they're tilted a lot. Right? So much that we can't even tell which one used to be on the bottom. We can guess, but we can't be told for sure. Right? Look, do you see the cave over there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
From the cave, look left until you see a bush with yellow flowers. See that?
Yeah.
Okay, now go straight up from there and you see there's some gray rock kind of sitting into a little indent in the quartzite. You see that? And now at the very left side of that, there's some gray rock that's sitting on top of some quartzite. Okay, so that gray rock is tillite and that's older than the quartzite. So how do you think on that side, how did the older rock get on top of the quartzite?
Moving.
Okay, it obviously moved, right?
I don't know.
So look up here at my hands, I'll show you. Okay, so the layers are originally like this, with the tillite on the bottom, right? Now if there's enough compression, things will start to fold, right? And tilt a little bit. But if there's a lot and it's tight, there's gonna be a fault that forms, so it's gonna be slipped. And then you might even get it so that older rock is pushed up on top. And that's called a thrust fault. It's a type of reverse fault. It's formed from compression, okay? Make sure you got that, because I think you need that to answer any of the questions that were on the questions for this one.
Yeah.
Okay. So, any questions on that?
How is a normal fault?
Huh?
Before, how do you form a normal fault?
A normal fault is what you call it when the rocks are being pulled apart. Like the Wasatch Fault is a normal fault. It's formed as the valley separated from the mountain. Anyone want to guess what that cave is? How it formed? I'll give you a hint, it's man-made.
A dynamite.
A bomb.
Wait.
Chiseled by hand for thousands of people.
That's actually an old entrance to a mine.
What's that?
Well, technically.
So, and if you look at the mine entrance, you see that it's right between the layers of quartzite and the layer of tillite. So right at the boundary between the two rock layers. Anyone know why they would put it there? Why would they want the boundary? Any guess?
Abandoned mine.
Huh?
Abandoned mine.
Why is it right at the boundary?
Because they wanted to get both of them at the same time.
Close.
Yeah.
So now quartzite and tillite, they're both pretty common rocks. They're not worth a lot on their own. Okay, let me look here real quick. I'll show you something. Everyone, eyes over here. Look here real quick. Do you see on this rock, do you see the white lines here? There's some here, there's some on that side, vertically. So these white lines are calcite deposits that formed as water seeped into a crack. Okay? The water seeped into the crack of these rocks and left behind this calcite and filled it up. Okay? So when you have a crack between rocks, like you would have between layers, it's easier for water to flow because you have an open space. And when you have water and an open space, that's a great place to form minerals, okay? Like crystals, gemstones, things like that. So mines are often put in that kind of place to look for things like that, to look for, you know, the emeralds or rubies, topaz, any kind of precious gemstones.
Why was it abandoned?
I would guess it probably just wasn't as successful as I hoped. They didn't find enough. It's been closed for several decades now, and it's sealed off with bars. So
let's go break the bars.
So any last questions about anything here?
Welcome, I'm Heath Ogden. I'm a professor of biology at Utah Valley University. They asked me to come and talk to you guys a little bit. I know that it sounds like you guys have already learned a little bit about food webs and energy flow in a system, right?
Yes.
I think it'd be more fun just talk about insects the rest of the day. I'm an entomologist too, I study insects. But let's do a multiple choice question to begin with. Can you pick that end up?
What eat up?
Can everyone look at this? There is some definite mass here. If you don't believe me, after you can come up and try to lift it up, okay? So here's the question. You guys have to choose one of these four options. Where did the mass of this wood come from? Option number one, sunlight. Option number two, nutrients in the ground. Option number three, water. Option number four, out of the air.
Water.
Did you get it? Wait before you answer. So it's gonna be sunlight, nutrients in the ground, water, out of the air, okay? So think about it, and then I want everyone to put up your finger on which option you think. One, two, three, or four. Everyone has to choose something. Don't worry about being wrong. It's okay to be wrong, because you'll learn. I promise, it's okay. Okay, here we go. Everyone put up your option. What do you think? One, two, three, or four?
Which one is one?
Water was three.
It's a trick question.
Water was three. It's not a trick question. There's an absolute answer for it.
Okay. I don't remember which one it was.
So what you're going to do? You're just going to Hunger Game me? All right. Hunger Game me. All right. Okay. So how many said water? How many said sunlight, which was number one? How many said nutrients in the ground, number two? And how many said air? No one said air? Someone should have said air because that's the correct answer. You said air? So air is... Put it down. Air is the correct answer because this is cellulose. Cellulose comes from sugars that plants make, and plants make their sugars from carbon dioxide that they get out of the atmosphere when they do photosynthesis. So it wasn't a trick question. There's actually a really easy answer to this. So producers produce the lowest level energy that's available, which is that cellulose or sugars. Like when you eat a fruit, you're eating mostly sugars, and then there's water there as well, and there's some fibers, some cellulose fibers as well. But that all came from the atmosphere to begin with, right? So many of you talked about some of the things you've seen on the way up, some insects. Did anyone see any mammals?
No.
Yeah, I saw humans.
Oh, good. There are some humans. I didn't see any mammals. I was looking for some. Sometimes you'll see mountain goats up on the sides here, but I didn't see any. Did you even see any reptiles?
Me.
You did? What'd you see? One of the groups saw a lizard, and one of the groups saw a snake. Did anyone see any birds?
No.
I saw lots of birds. But the birds all I saw were all first level.
There's a bird right there.
Now that bird is a what kind of a bird though?
A small bird.
No, that one up there?
Yeah.
No, that's a bird of prey.
What is
it? Looks like a hawk. I can't tell. It's really far away, but it looks like a hawk.
Where?
Can
someone drag my water?
It's, you kind of have to focus way off in the distance, but it's up there.
It's black.
So on your sheet it says the biodiversity of food webs. One of the main things that causes food webs to be more biodiverse is the producers. And producers need sunlight, they need the air, but they also need water. So even though water doesn't become the majority of the mass of this dry piece of wood, water is still important. So I want you to pay attention for just a moment. Just look around and try to get an idea for how many insects are flying around right now.
A lot.
Well, just look. Okay, now take 20 steps with me to the edge over here. And if you hear, you'll hear water there. Some of that water is actually draining right over here.
Can I go for water?
So I need about 3 or 4 brave souls. Hopefully someone who has a camera as well. Go down there. And then get an impression and compare the amount of insects down there to where you were just at up here, okay? So about 3 or 4 people go down. Let's not have everyone go down, but about 3 or 4.
Can I go now? Is there water?
Hopefully some down there. Can you see all the little tiny flies? There's tons of little flies too. I mean, there's like hundreds of flies down there too that you can't see because they're nice and small. All right, come back up.
So now you made me more thirsty.
Sorry, do you know what?